OTEP community, welcome back to the Philippe Matthew Show Live. Thank you for tuning in wherever you are around the world. We've got him back. I've asked him to be a part of this seemingly ongoing discussion about what was going on in the minds of the Bothams and in that courtroom in Dallas, Texas, with the brother not saying, I forgive you, I love you, can I have a hug? And then the judge, I think her name is Kemp, Judge Kemp, giving a Bible and a hug to the murderer. Mm-hmm. And a couple of days prior to that, the memes went berserk when we saw the court gesture stroking the head of the murderer. Yes. And consoling her.
Psychological setup. That's what that was.
Get
you ready.
Right. So a quick announcement on the show, an exclusive. The other day, when I was talking about how I don't want to become an alcoholic, I recognized that this stress of racial battle fatigue and the constant work that I have to do and research for the show and all of that was taking a toll. And I saw that I was going down a path similar to the path of my father. And so as a result, I took my last drink that day. So I'm done. And so I want to send a shout out to Prince Idris, who called me up. All of you who have commented on the show and in the last Amber Guyger show that we discussed, or episode that we discussed. Reverend Adrian Jones, thank you for reaching out. Mother Me, Dr. Nzinga Dalila. You know, I love you like a sister, and Elder Nicole Hurst. All of you just showed me so much love and support. So I just want to personally thank you. Bottle water is what I'm drinking now.
Yeah.
And cleaning up my act and living in that first frequency. So that being said,
absolutely.
Let me welcome back Brandon Jones, psychotherapist, professor, behavioral health consultant. Specializing in adverse childhood experiences, historical and intergenerational trauma, social, emotional intelligence, leadership, and youth justice from Minnesota. Welcome back, Brandon Jones.
Greetings, Philippe. Thank you for having me yet again. It's always a pleasure to be on the Philippe Matthews Show. The shock is what I call it. And I know you love your cigars and your scotch, man. So I want to commend you for taking that step of, you know, taking care of yourself, which I think is a great segue into what we've experienced this week with this. Actually, since this case has gone on and many more cases to go, is how we have to take care of ourselves in this world and society that we live in. Because, as you know, these four frequencies are very interesting. And at any given day, we can find ourselves on frequency 2, frequency 4, 3, or 1, just depending on what happens. So we all need to take better care of ourselves. And that's where I see my kind of role in this work is to make sure from a mental and emotional standpoint, we're doing our best to cope and address our issues so that we don't get pulled down, because there are many traps. There are many setups for us to not be mentally well, because when you're not mentally well, you're often confused. And when you're confused, you are easily controlled. So that's what, so, you know, salute to you and salute to anybody else who has ever dealt with any addiction, any level of addiction. And I'm not saying you were an addict per se, but anybody who struggled with any addiction.
Oh, I was working on it. I was trying to perfect it, all I'm saying. I was working. So, you know, I try to be the best at everything I do, you know.
I would call that a direction,
you know.
Yeah, absolutely. I would call that a habitual drinker. So
That's right. You know, but you know, when you start, I caught myself, I started making excuses, you know, like, I don't need one, but I'll just have one, 'cause that's what I do. And then it just started, you know, I'm like, and because I've worked with so many people in addiction, I saw myself in my own data. I'm like, wait a minute. What the hell, dude? Lee, come on, man. You know. So, luckily, being first frequency, because I also became a vegetarian about 4 months ago. Haven't even craved meat or anything like that. In fact, Yolanda now, my queen, she's not only eating vegetarian, she's cooking it. And I'm like, whoa, who are you? You are my ride and die. That's my bae right there. And so we're just cleaning up our act and trying to have positive adaptations to the racial battle fatigue, the post-traumatic slavery syndrome, the micro and macroaggressions, because maladaptive behaviors are maladaptive behaviors. And that's what we normally and naturally do. And so you remember we were talking about, Brandon, I was trying to produce a show with you, Dr. O, and a few, and Cobb and a few others, talking about, is it mental illness or is it racial battle fatigue? When I look at what's happening in our community, I say, you know, everybody says, well, mental illness, mental. Well, why all of a sudden we became mentally ill? It's like a crescendo. It's like the ish has really hit the fan. The frequency of microaggressions and racial battle fatigue is so strong and so hard that we're now just mentally breaking down. We can't take it anymore because we don't know that we're first frequency people. We don't know we have a Brandon Jones to be able to give us some ancestral love and therapy to help us overcome. And so I'm not certain that if we were not in the situation that we're in or born into, would we have all of these crazy behaviors and all of this mental illness that we're talking about? That being said, fam, particularly those who might be watching this for the first time, and you haven't seen the first episode that we did or first show we did on this Amber Guyger trial. So we're dealing with yet another police shooting an unarmed man in the most, for lack of better vocabulary, ridiculous terms. It's like, hey, this is in my apartment. Who are you? And I'm mistaken. Your apartment for mine, even though you had a red mat at the door to distinguish that this is I don't have a red mat on mine, but I didn't see that. And so, and for some reason, the door was unlocked.
Yeah.
Come in, I shoot you dead while you're eating ice cream. And so, you know, we look at the tampering of evidence. We look at the erasure of evidence, text messages and what have you. We look at her behaviors after that and we say, oh my God, this chick is not well. Mm-hmm. The person, as we call it. So a year goes by. We basically look at it and say, well, the same thing that happened before is going to happen again. They get off. Well, she didn't get off. She got convicted of murder. And it was like amazing. But then something happened, something that even some of the devout Christians that I know have called me and said, Philippe, what the hell was that? And they're Christians. And so no knock on Christianity, but we do have to have a conversation about it. But the next day for sentencing, we saw Botham's younger brother get on the stand and say, hey, I wish you didn't have to go to jail. Mm-hmm. I love you. I wish the best for you. And can I have a hug? And begged the judge, who was crying, Judge Kemp, who was crying. And she said, yes, acquiesced. And so there was the hug. We all saw that photo. Mm-hmm. So that was enough to have several shows and conversations about. Right.
Right.
No. Let's keep it going.
Right.
So a few moments later, the judge Kemp goes over to the family, consoles them, hugs them, which you don't normally see, but you know, under the circumstances, we could understand that. But then something really strange happened. She went and got a Bible and went over to Amber Guyger and started consoling her and then hugged her as well. The judge hugged the person who just got sentenced to 10 years. And they, by the way, that 10-year sentence now has come out. The jurors were coming out talking about, it was two jurors, one white, one a white guy and a black woman, who was talking about, well, they were just feeling such empathy for Amber Guyger.
Yeah.
And it was blowing my mind. I'm like, what happened here? Right. So to bring some sense to this and bring a psychoanalytic perspective to this that specializes in our community. Brandon Jones, help a brother out. Yes. Help me understand why I stopped drinking over this, okay? Let's just talk about that.
Well, again, we have been manipulated through the media. You know, you said a lot, so I'm trying to figure out which the best way to start. We'll get to the media manipulation piece in a moment. Let's talk about what you started off with the question: is it racial battle fatigue or is it mental illness? And what my answer to that question is: it's a combination of both. Racial battle fatigue. If you are someone who's experiencing racial battle fatigue, and my assumption is, if you're Black and you live in the United States, at the very least, if not the world, just in general, you're experiencing some level of racial battle fatigue. It might look different in different places, but absolutely here in the United States, you are absolutely dealing with racial battle fatigue. Since that is the case, but off top, you are having some emotional distress. So I'm not going to say mental illness. You're having some emotional distress, which means you might have some hypervigilance. You might have some confusing thoughts. You might have some paranoia. You might have some levels of anxiety. You might have some issues where you can't make executive thinking. So your prefrontal lobe isn't getting the right signals that it should get because your amygdala and your limbic system, which is on these sides of the mind, are overstimulated due to this perceived threat or something that's not going right. So those things cause emotional distress. You might have some depressive symptoms, et cetera. Mental illness is kind of taking that a whole nother step forward. So mental illness is when you are clinically meeting the criteria of an actual mental health disorder. Every Black person does not already meet that criteria. However, we might have symptoms that show up in the criteria for those labels, but we might not actually be mentally ill. And there are actually diagnoses that we call adjustment disorders in the world of mental health and psychology, where you have symptomology of these things, but you don't quite meet the criteria just yet, and you get what's called an adjustment disorder, which means you're struggling with something. You've been struggling with it for quite some time, might be a month, might be 3 months, but you don't fit the criteria for major depression or anxiety or whatever the case may be.
Fantastic. Wow. That's why we have you on, because we needed that breakdown. Yes. That racial battle fatigue, these micro and macroaggressions, you know, I have had countless people comment on various different shows that I've done over the years. And one of the ongoing themes when they finally arrive to my content is, I knew I wasn't crazy.
Yeah.
So that's one of the quotes. I knew I wasn't crazy. Here is Dr. Joy talking about PTSS, or here is Dr. William A. Smith talking about racial battle fatigue. Here's Brandon talking about arrested development.
Right.
The other thing that they say is that I have been saying this all along, but nobody is hearing me.
Yes.
And you know, you and I were having a conversation in the green room about how we feel like we are, you know, like within our family dynamic, within our work dynamic, that we're sitting up watching all of these method actors acting out insanity. And we're the only ones that are like, well, can somebody yell cut? So, so we can get back to normal, but it never does. And nobody ever yells cut. And so you're suspended and almost trapped in this matrix, this holodeck. You know, this false reality of all of these, you know, second, third, fourth frequency people interacting, and then they're asking you, hey, you got to come on out and do your part. So now you've got to play cray cray just to get along in your family dynamic or your work dynamic and social dynamic,
which makes you crazy.
That's going to create some stress because you're not being authentic to your first frequency self.
Yeah.
Even if you, God forbid, if you don't even know that you offer a frequency, where do you go? What do you do, Brandon?
Right. Many of us know. We feel that discomfort. We know. And I think I believe I covered this at one point in time on the show before, but we have a lot of folks who get into consciousness like myself. And then we start to, one of the first things we do when we get some knowledge, we run into one of our favorite you know, conscious Black leaders that we've had, whether that's Dr. Francis Cress Welsing, or, you know, whether that's John Henry Clark or whoever, and then we want to share that information, and it automatically gets rejected because, again, it's like having that red pill in the Matrix. You're trying to awaken someone to something that they're not ready for, or is discomfort. So yes, you will be in this quote unquote matrix and sitting around watching these people play their parts in this movie role, because what else are they supposed to do? That's the path of least resistance. And when you come into consciousness, that is a resistant thing to just change your mentality and change your mind. So when we see the brother hugging the officer, when we see the judge comforting the officer, when we see the other officer come and combing her hair, all very bizarre behaviors that I have never heard of in any court setting ever. I don't know if I've ever seen or heard that. So when I didn't see it till people were bringing it to me, and I was like, I had to go see it, because I'm like,
I thought it was an SNL sketch. I thought I didn't think it was real. I thought people were bizarre. Just, you know, why are you putting 100 on 10? You know, like a comedian bizarre. Or something. That can't be right. You know, who's going to do that?
Just bizarre stuff. And so, again, we have been conditioned. Let me start from the beginning. When Africans were captured on the continent and sold into slavery by other African warring tribes, that started the process to where we are. The Mayafa 21, that whole transatlantic slave trade that took place, and then that conditioning that took place once they landed on the shores of South America, the Caribbean islands, and North America, and put us into this whole slavery psychology dynamic is how I look at it. That set forth what we see today. So it's better off that you play a role just for your basic survival. And we have gone generation after generation after generation, something that we call transmissions theory. Dr. Joy DeGruy-Leary talks about this all the time, of us responding and coping to white supremacy, us responding and coping to this system that is very anti-Black, to the point now it has manifested itself in a 2020 kind of millennium or millennial type of framework, where we see these types of behaviors where all we can do is forgive, because deep down inside, that's all we've been trained to do. Take abuse, be harmed, be killed, and forgive, and keep moving forward. And when we do that, it takes a piece away from you. It takes away some of your agency. It takes away from your ancestors. It takes away from your future when we do things like that. But psychologically, it's been so ingrained and conditioned in us, many people don't see anything wrong with it. And yes, religion has a lot to do with this. Christianity has a whole lot to do with this. Absolutely, because those are the institutions or the instruments that get us to believe and understand and to move in that kind of formation, where we take pain, we take being brutalized, we take not having opportunities, we take having things taken from us, and we just deal with it and believe that God is going to set a better place for us in the afterlife instead of having that better place for us here. And we settle for nothing. We settle for less. We settle for that low frequency, and that's your aim, and that's where you should be, is on the bottom, subjugated. This reminds me of what Dr. Francis Cress Welsing has told us. This whole case goes right back to the Cress Welsing theory. I don't know if people understand that. Black man murdered in his home by a white woman. The Black man is the threat, right? You know, he gets shot twice in the chest on his couch. Bleeds out. And then we fast forward to the case. We don't even know what's been happening since this case broke news months ago until you know, really 2 weeks ago. That's the first time she done popped back up. We don't know what's taking place in the meantime. She pops back up now, and now there's all these questions. Will she get off? Will she not get off? And then what happens? Tuesday, we get the verdict that they're going to convict her, but we don't get any information. And everybody's celebrating. Automatically, mentally, we've already been sent off on a signal that, okay, this, we finally got one, even though there's been other cops who've been convicted, but this is the one. We got one, right? So now we got one. We got Black folks celebrate. Believe it or not, believe it, before all this happened on Wednesday, we were celebrating.
No question.
We had the meme. I seen the memes. Yep. I seen the post. Yes, we got one. Ooh, everybody got excited.
Yep.
And then you had other folks saying, you know, they're making excuses. Yeah, well, she's going to jail, but they're only doing it because she's a woman, right? So now you're starting the disentanglement of societies and groups. So you got Black folks celebrating, happy, mentally and emotionally on a high, and you got, you know, white folks and other folks. I ain't just gonna just say white folks, non-Black folks who are saying, well, they're only arresting her, and you got some Black folks in that group too, by the way, right, saying they only arresting her because she's a woman. Not even 24 hours later, they done hit the switch on us, and now we are mentally messed up yet again. Because she only got what? She only got 10 years. Oh, wait. I forgot a part. Let me rewind the tape back to Tuesday. So we get the guilty verdict, but we also get this very bizarre clip that leaks out of the officer who's stroking her hair.
Right, right.
And shout outs to Tariq Nasheed, because he's one of the first people that I've seen put it out like, what is this?
Right, right.
And why did they decide to go to commercial break, but for some reason pan the camera and keep it here while we have people, while this woman's
even the cameraman, even the white cameraman was looking and like, what in the hell is this?
Psychological control. So we're going to give her a conviction. Have you ever heard of somebody being convicted, but the details don't come out to the day late? Like all that for a case this large, right? For a case this large, usually they let you know this person's convicted for this, this, and this, and get it out the way, right? Or this person's off and they get out the way. This was all setting you up. We're going to convict her, but we're not going to tell you how long. We're still in, debating on what we're going to do. Why even come out and tell us on Tuesday then? Let us get all the information all together. But that's a whole other thing. So Tuesday's Tuesday. We got Black folks on emotional high. We got this kind of racial divide thing going on. We got this people and a gender issue, because now they're saying, well, she's a woman and that's why she's getting convicted. Then you get to Wednesday and now the information comes out. She's getting 10 years, but that 10 years comes with what? Psychological control. It comes with first the brother who's on the stand pleading the case. I don't even know why he's talking. Why is he even talking? She's already been convicted. He should have been talking on Monday. Why is he talking? Psychological control, right? So he's talking. He's pleading. He's pretty much pleading. He's giving her a plea, like, don't even take her to jail. It's going to be okay. And then he asks her for a hug. All this is theatrics, man. Like, what the media mind control thing, and I'm not trying to get into my conspiracy theory stuff, but you got to think about this. Like, what? Why is this happening?
Right.
And why is this on? Why is this being broadcasted? That's the other thing. Like, why? Let me make a quick parallel real fast. Officer Noor, the officer up here in Minnesota, the Somali officer who shot and killed the white woman. I don't know if people remember this case.
That. Yes.
None of that was on cameras. Have we heard anything about that? Mm. Did we get the white family on camera talking about we forgive Officer Noor and we want to hug him? We didn't get any of that. Same incident. Officer shoots unarmed person, but the officer was a black Somali man, shot a white woman. So if we want to make a parallel between the two cases, we almost have a direct parallel. Because I believe his family was, I believe the man who was shot in his home in Dallas, his family was from St. Lucia, correct?
Mm-hmm.
Almost exact parallel. But look at the media control.
Yes.
They could have easily had CNN cameras up here in Minnesota for that trial. Easy. Mm-hmm. Easy. Wasn't on there. Why is this being shown to you? Like, this is my thing. I don't want to get into the details of the case. I want to look at why it's being presented the way it's being presented and what is the purpose behind that. Again, if we can keep you emotionally unstable, we can keep you in a place where you're not thinking logically or critically, and we can keep you in a high emotional state, we can get you to move the way you want to move, and we can disarm you. Because guess what happened on Wednesday? The narrative shifted from the cop who murdered this man in his own home to look at these black folks cooning and taking care of this white woman. That's so right. Automatically, we got taken off. We got taken off our mission, our code, and focusing back on us, which highlights our level of anti-blackness. We have to work on this, man. Like this is why I am starting to do my work. I'm starting to shift away from talking about white supremacy, because white supremacy has created a whole nother monster that if white supremacy disappeared, we're going to still struggle with. And that thing is called anti-blackness. We have been so psychologically damaged by white supremacy that's all we will push white supremacy out the way to beat up on ourselves. Absolutely. And this is not a new concept. I mean, we have had Bobby E. Wright. We've had Khalid Muhammad, Amos Wilson, Sherazad Ali. Can I keep going? People who talked about this. This is not a new thing.
Right.
But we have to break that psychological enslavement and that psychological hatred that we've created for ourselves before we can do anything. Because guess what? One day, white supremacy is going to be gone. And we're going to have some Asians to deal with.
Right.
Some Indians to deal with. Some other Africans to deal with.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to have other people to deal with. We have to think global. We can't be local no more. Local in government, yes. Organize locally with who you're around that have similar goals. But globally focus, because this world is shrinking. And if we're going to continue to get thrown off our mission and our path over a case like this, we are in for a lot of hell, because there's a lot more coming our way that I believe there's a lot more coming our way that we're not ready for. And white supremacy is just the tip of the iceberg. Yeah, and it is a global system, by the way. But anti-blackness is just as global, because we might get treated differently in different cultures, but we still have a place when we leave outside the United States where you're supposed to fit and stay. So we got a lot of work to do. That's it.
you're 100%. And you know, I one of the reasons that I am in pursuit of my doctorate in metaphysical science and philosophy is because I really wanted to get deep into research and get access to research that most of us are not privy to, but from a metaphysical perspective and from what I call a first frequency perspective. And understanding really who we are, and that what we're dealing with is we're always dealing with frequencies and signals. You know, media is a signal, frequency. Internet is a frequency, it's a signal. When we read a newspaper or listen to the radio, all of those are signals. Even though you're physically holding something and reading it, your brain is transferring that into bits of data. So, so I wrote this special report series called The Hidden Signal, The Metaphysics of Racial Battle Fatigue. And thank you for reading that and endorsing that.
Absolutely. Brad. Great work.
Because I, in my, I'll be 54 in November, in my 53 and a quarter years, I've never researched and written anything that scathing, I would say, as it relates to what we call second frequency people. I mentioned this on the show last show, Brother Otieno Warriario from the Motherland, Saul Cobb and I, and you as well, doing a series of different shows and said, you know what? I've been studying this. I can corroborate. He's an engineer. I can corroborate all of your research, all of your, theories and suggestions. So he reached out to Cobb and reached out to me and started sharing his research. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, whoa, wait a minute now. What are we dealing with here? And he was speaking and writing in a frequency, from a frequency perspective and understanding. And so what we're up against, family, what I put into this special report is we're dealing with a virus. We're dealing with an actual omission, a virus, a frequency that causes us to submit and obey. Now, I'm going to read, if I may, two paragraphs from the special report and what Otieno shared with us. Now, if this is the first time again for you coming to the show, you probably haven't heard of what is this first and second frequency? You feel like you're in an Abbott and Costello thing, like who's on first, what's on second? I don't know, he's on third. Okay, so first frequency people, It's us. It's gods. It's gods and goddesses. It's the people from the motherland. It's the original people. It's the first frequency people, because we were first chosen by God, the Creator, to be put here and master this, master heaven and earth. When some of those Europeans say they are chosen, it's impossible. You can't come in second and be chosen. We are the chosen people. And so first frequency is the highest frequency of our nature. And it's what we have access to 24/7, because that's just the way, that's how much the Creator loves us. And the Creator obviously loves black, because everything comes from the black. If you don't believe me, go back and look at a Dr. Sabi piece talking about carbon. So before you can talk about melanin, you got to talk about carbon. So carbon is black. So we understand that. So we're first frequency people. So then I said, well, what happened to these Africans who went to a particular area in the world and got caught up in a climatic event that happened over 103,000 years? And as Professor Kaba tells us, that the ice came from the bottom up, not from the top down. So over and gradually over 44,000 generations, these Africans began to freeze. Their brains began to freeze, because their brains were in such harsh temperatures, 100 below, 200 below in some cases. Talking to Dr. David Imhotep, he says that last 5,000 years, Philippe, is really when they came into, when their psychopathy came into being, and they became anti-African. It was like the climate turned those original Africans inside out in every shape, form, and fashion, phenotype, right, psychologically, spiritual, everything, and created an anti-African. And when they right. came out and saw Africans, it was just about death and destruction and control from that point on. So we call those second frequency people. These second frequency people come over here and create a label, yet another label of humanity that's called the Negro. And I call that third frequency, because that's not originally who we are. But in order for our parents to survive, in order for our ancestors to have survived here, we had to be Negroes. And what does a Negro mean? And what does a Negro do? What is a good Negro? You know, or we now, in my generation, the Gen X, creating hip hop, we rejected that generation's mindset, and we looked at them as coons, and we looked at colorism and all that stuff, and we started rejecting that. And so we went from the nigger and the Negro to the real nigga with an A on it. So we put that flavor on it. We call it a term of endearment. And that's what I call fourth frequency. The issue is that you cannot solve any of our problems in third or fourth frequency. You can't solve a problem with the same false label that you're acting within that created the problem. To solve the problem. So here we are dealing with these various frequencies, recognizing who we are for the first time. And so this piece that I'm going to read to you is what I call this signal, and what we have been uncovering from just understanding what racial battle fatigue is. The second frequency virus objective is to stop first frequency people from independently sensing and remembering each other by interrupting our free will signal and senses, disrupting and discrediting our independent thoughts and senses between male and female original people, both here in America and on the motherland, along with the reality of time and space. So this signal, this frequency, second frequency, is designed to make us forget who we are. It's designed to divide and conquer, divide and separate. If you remember the shows I've done with Dr. Battalore, I asked her, I said, what was the purpose of white people? She says it only serves two purposes: to divide and conquer humanity, and to protect the 1%. That is what second frequency people are. what it's designed to do. And if you identify as white, you are always doing more harm than good. It goes on to say frequency reduction and second frequency colonization is how the virus approaches first frequency people. It either approaches violently or by imaginary claims. Second frequency virus is designed for you to deny your sense of origin and birth from your own mother. It devalues your sense of what you touch, see, and hear. So don't believe anything that you see. Don't believe anything that you, I don't care what this videotape looks like. I don't care what you experience. It's not what you experience. And so it's all about that mass confusion. It says using religion by claiming your birth was worthless and that you need to be born again into an imaginary existence. Then they use social orders to deny your independent sense of touch, sight, and sound. Social orders like religion, capitalism, social media, and education. This is what we're up against, family. I'm going to be sharing that special report with you once I complete it. I still have some more research to put into it. But think about that, that white, I know Brandon don't want to talk, but whiteness, let's just call it whiteness, the frequency of whiteness, second frequency, is designed to separate you from your mother. What does that mean? From your motherland, from your origins. Now, Dr. Obadashaka has taught us the sixfold stages to mental freedom. That, to me, is a blueprint to get back home to first frequency. Because when you look, the sixfold stages are assimilation, black identity, pre-disturbance, disturbance, African identity, and revolutionary consciousness. Revolutionary consciousness is first frequency. But assimilation is where the Negro was created and where we had to be in order to survive, that third frequency. We still had somewhat of a black identity because we were black people, but it was hijacked because we wanted to assimilate. We wanted to not be segregated, which in one way, even though during Jim Crow, there was a positive and negative to any energy. The positive was we were forced to work together and we were building a nation. But then when we integrated and assimilated, you're assimilating into a second frequency signal that is designed to destroy you, to destroy your memory of who you are, to destroy your hope, your dreams, your potential, to cause you not to be able to see yourself in the future, viable, thriving, to keep you in a constant state of survivalship, to keep you in a constant state of being what's that stress that you call it? Brandon, there's a term that you use where you're constantly under a level of stress.
Yeah, survival stress management.
Survival stress management. And so this signal, every time you are around second frequency people, the question that you always have to ask yourself is, how is that signal causing me to be subservient? How is that signal causing me to be obedient? When we look at the Amber Guyger situation, we looked at the behaviors of these of our people. One of the things that is, and Dr. Robin DiAngelo talks about this as well. When the second frequency virus, like a parasite, remember we did that show with Professor Cabo on parasite rex. When a parasite recognizes it's going to be annihilated, it's going to be eradicated, it does whatever is necessary for it to survive. And so one of the things that has always been the go-to that makes us submit yet again is white tears.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
When we see a white woman crying, shit. You know, we pulling out the checkbook, you know, we driving to Costco to get baby milk and similar. We do whatever the hell it takes because that is what the virus, the frequency, the parasite, the signal is supposed to do. if you do not recognize it, you get what we saw, what you saw with your own eyes in the Amber Guyger sentencing. Brandon. Right.
And I would also say that this is a signal. This is a signal for us to make sure that we're responding as most appropriately as we can when we get into these situations. Unfortunately, this will not be the last court case that is going to be broadcasted that has Black folks losing at the end of it. I mean, we just went through this a year ago with the OJ situation all over again. I mean,
well, the OJ, all right. But remember Dylan Roof, same thing.
Dylan Roof, yeah.
I forgive you. We forgive you.
Yes.
What?
And this, but again, we've been conditioned to forgive those who hurt us, to forgive those who pain us, and to fight those who are closest to us. That is the telltale sign of anti-Blackness and that psychological trauma that we've gone through from a cultural standpoint. So for those who are hearing this message, I would say take this as a signal as well to make sure you're doing what you need to do, just like you started off, Philippe, with the show earlier, about making those changes and about doing something to get your, not just your mental health, your physical health as well in the right shape, because we are on a battlefield, whether you want to call it racial battle fatigue or not. We are on a battle for our minds. We are in a battle for our futures. And if you're not equipped, to keep moving forward, this is what this life is about. It's a journey. It's not a destination. We're not gonna just get to the top of the mountain without some effort. We might not even get to the top mountain. This might not even be a mountain. It is going to be still a journey. It's still a destination. It's a process that we need to go through. And this is what you've been chosen. You didn't have to be born, but you've been chosen to do something different. And you've been chosen to leave an impact in this world, and you've been chosen to do something for those that you bring into this world or those that you care for in this world. You have to take care of yourself. We can't get distracted by these court cases. I would say that was definitely a dog and pony show, even though she did get 10 years. We know how this stuff works. She probably will only do about 4, if that. So keep this in mind.
Well, don't allow Judge Kemp, who has to preside over this, she'll probably be out tomorrow. I mean, they just love each other. Shit.
But again, we have to have the right people in these right systems. I mean, maybe Judge Kemp isn't the right person. She may resemble us, but mentality wise, she might not be there, right? Or who knows what the dynamic of that relationship is? But it's still, this is why it's important that we continue to organize. It's important that we continue to take care of ourselves. Two of the things that you're going to hear from me a lot more is talking about policy and personal development. Those are the two P's that we got to definitely focus on. We got to have our policy game on point, and we have to develop personally. I mean, when you take care of yourself, eventually those around you will take care of themselves as well. Or those around you who aren't taking care of themselves will stop messing with you because you are acting different, quote unquote. But you have to get healthy. Mentally, yes. Spiritually, physically, financially, healthier. We have to do better.
I have to say this too, Brandon. You know, one of the things that I think many of the people who are watching this right now and will later when it's archived on the channel, waking up, quote unquote, becoming woke, moving from disturbance to an African identity. For some of us, it's almost an assault to our natural axiological proclivity of being people to people, because you can't be around, you can't be around second frequency people on a regular basis without that signal and virus eventually sucking you into something. But then you might not be able to be around your own as well. That can really cause a sense of isolation, and because it goes against our own axiological proclivity of being people to people. What I say to that is, there's going to be an identity crisis you're going to go through and grow through when you wake up. I went through mine when I read Post-Traumatic Slave Syndrome. That was my, that was when I was disturbed. Prior to that, I was assimilated with a Black identity. I was going to unity churches and speaking around the country and around the world, and I was uniting everybody, namaste, namah, one love, yada, yada, yada. I didn't know anything about my history. I saw some that pre-disturbed me throughout my life in terms of racism, but never did I make a connection that this was a system. Never did I make the connection that this was a virus, that that white people were invented to divide and conquer as a matter of law prior to the Constitution. So as you start digging deeper and finding something out, every one of you watching now and listening to Brandon might remember that point, that disturbance point. Something right. happened. It might have been, for me, it was reading a book. For you, it could have been, you know, a situation that happened to you personally or somebody you love or just something you saw on social media. But you said, well, wait a minute. It happened to Brandon. It happened yeah. to Brandon. Same thing. He had a pre-disturbance, and then it was disturbed where he could not go back, and he had right. to start saying, wait a minute, this is Dr. Francis Chris Wilson, John Henry Clark. Who are these people? Right. What is it? Hey, that makes sense. Well, oh, snap, I didn't know. Oh, that's what's going on. We, you know, most of us don't know anything past slavery. That's why they want to keep that narrative going, is that you know, that's why you have third frequency people saying, I'm correct. Not African-American, I'm American.
Correct.
All right? You know, that's why you have states, God bless them. You know how the old people say, God bless a little soul. God bless a little heart, Stacey Dash.
Yeah,
you know, we don't need a BET. We don't need a Black History Month. Chickens come home to roost. She ends up marrying a second frequency person, gets into a domestic violence spout with her spouse, who happens to be an attorney. The police come and arrest her. Now, if you don't understand what's going on, I don't know what it takes, sister, for you to wake up. And then you don't even have enough money to bail yourself out. The husband who you claim was beating you or abusing you bailed you out. And yeah. and so let's understand that we are all coming at this in from various different worlds, situations, families, lifestyles, and you're going to feel alone. And perhaps one of the reasons why you have an affinity for my show, for Tyreek, for the cows, for the various different folks that are out here doing this type of work is because we're your new virtual family, because sometimes in your own family or in your work, you can't even bring this up. And if you're in a Christian family or Christian household or household of faith, then you have to look at common sense versus your faith. And now you're in a competition with, yeah, okay, you're a Christian. All right, that's not necessarily a bad thing, but
right.
What how is it harming you? How is it harming your family? There are pros and cons to everything. There's a positive and negative to everything. But this thing called Christianity, if you don't know the origin and you think that the origin in the Bible and everything is literal, well, one, you're not listening to this show anyway because you're not allowed. But if you do a little bit of homework, not a lot, just a little, you will right. understand that this is a signal frequency that's trying to stop you, control you, and cause you to run out of time, run out of energy, and die, and have no contribution whatsoever. That's what we're up against, Brandon.
Yes. One point, just to follow up on what you're saying, is I don't want people who are Christians to feel like this is an indictment on them, because it's not.
Right, because it's not.
But what we do have to be honest about is that Christianity has led to a lot of our downfall at the same time. I think that there's a lot of benefits and beautifulness inside of Christianity, but it is a tool. It is an institutional tool to get people to move in a particular direction. And if you don't have agency, if you don't have a Black center, you will get manipulated in that tool, just like any other tool, the school system, you know, other religious groups or spiritual groups, even in the conscious community. If you don't have a center, you will get directed into areas and places that you don't want to be directed into. So don't take this as an indictment because of how you identify from a religious or a spiritual standpoint. Take this as a signal of what are you missing, if you're missing anything, and what can you do with that information to empower yourself and in turn, hopefully empower those ones that are around you at the same time. So on that note, I don't know what else to say. If you are someone.
Man, listen, you have a free e-course.
Yes.
And you also have a membership program.
Yeah, I'll talk about all that.
Because we need you now. We need this now more than ever before, Brandon.
Yeah, let's talk about a couple things.
We need to send this to the Bothams. I'm just saying they might need to hear this and sign up to Brandon's membership. You know, oh my gosh. Go ahead, Brandon. What? How can people connect with you and what do you have to offer?
So to connect with me, I would suggest that you go to jegna.org. That's J-E-G-N-A. That's J-E-G-N-A.org. There you will find the link to the membership site. The membership site hosts several different e-courses. And in those, one of those e-courses is free. The link will also be in the description, I'm sure, where you can get access to the free e-course. That one's called Legacy of Trauma. It's a free 5-day e-course. And what I go through is from the plantation till now, how have we gone through the psychological trauma standpoint and what does it look like on all different stages from where we were from actual slaves and enslaved Africans to where we are today as Black people. So that is for free. It's a 5-day video course. It's over 2 hours of content. It's great. Check it out. If you are someone who's ready for that personal development piece and you're ready to just dive in, I have an audiobook called Level Elite. And Level Elite is an audiobook that's focused on developing what I call your self-development, right? This is your personal development piece. And self-development is an acronym for survival, education, for legacy, and future. So this is something helping you move forward in the work that we do. And then thirdly, coming very, very soon will be my first book. It's going to be an ebook and it's called Healing is a Journey.
Yay. Right?
A guide for wellness and self-mastery.
I can't wait.
Been working on this thing for a while. I hope that it doesn't disappoint. I don't think it will, but I definitely need people to definitely get ready for that because that's coming very, very soon within the next couple of weeks. So Healing is a Journey, a guide for wellness and self-mastery. We got the e-courses at Jegna Institute, and we have the audiobook Level Elite. So if anything that I said made some sense and you want to check me out further, definitely go to jegna.org, J-E-G-N-A.org.
Fantastic. Family, thank you so much for being patient with me. Thank you for going on this journey with me. Brandon, thank you for going on the journey with me as well. I consider you a family member. A family member who can see you in your first frequency and understand what you're going through.
Right.
And also, family, I see you as well. The love that you guys pour out to me, it's overwhelming sometimes, I have to admit. And I just break down in joyful tears because as I said, you know, sometimes you feel alone, but I know that I'm not alone. And I want you to know that you're not alone and that we are with you. We feel your pain because we've been Black a long time and we're all Black together. And so you're not the only one feeling this. I know you might feel that you are, you're not. Reach out, watch the show, comment, share, do whatever it takes to interface with a frequency that will lift you up, recognize you as the God and goddess that you are, recognize that you are an original human, H-U-E, man and woman, a womb man. And guess what? We'll see you next time on the Philippe Matthew Show Live. Uncle Japs and that fam. Hotep Brandon.
Hotep.
Thank you.
Peace.